Well, good morning, church. It's so good to be with you. Let's stand. Would you sing some Christmas songs with us this morning? To certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep.
Christmas songs and just enjoy one another while we're here this morning. And look, I just want to draw your attention to two quick things this morning. One, on December the 15th, over at the East Campus, we're going to do a Christmas concert, literally 1 hour of your favorite Christmas stuff. It's going to have our strings from the, are anybody familiar with the strings from the other campus? Like, it's an incredible string choir, I guess, orchestra. I'm not real cultured. I guess it's called an orchestra.
The string choir.
Hey, they can make them strings sing. So an orchestra. I'm getting made fun of by the band behind me. It's hilarious. But you can go and check that out. It's going to be incredible. It's on a Sunday night, the 15th. It's going to be great. Also coming up on the 21st. I'm really excited about this one, is Jingle Jam Unwrapped. It's going to be a family-friendly Christmas experience. So what we want you to do is bring every person that you know, young and old. It's going to be so much fun. It's going to be funny. There'll be some comedy. I'm going to be a part of it. But I'm not that funny. So there's going to be comedy. There's going to be the Christmas story told in a very unique way. So my hope is that you will bring families there, and they and their kids are going to hear the Christmas story. And just maybe, this is your opportunity to bring that person that you've desperately wanted to see come to know the Lord. This might be the perfect night for you to bring them. And that's on the 21st. Can't wait for that, so make sure that you get there. Look, if this is your very first time, we're so glad you're here this morning. Make sure you stop by the table on your way out outside. It says, hey, if you're new here, say hello. Stop by that table and get connected. They have some stuff for you there, and we can't wait to see what God has for you. I know Pastor Scott's going to talk about joy this morning. How desperately do we need joy in our life, and what a great season to really dial in and focus on that. So let's continue to worship.
This morning, that no matter what season or difficulty that we're in, that the Lord is always there and His presence is always with us.
There's a grace when the heart is undefined, another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, no, I'll never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning. Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. Grace. presence still is, and we'll be through it all. So come what may, in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning, I know I will.
Your name
Another Christmas song for you guys. Hope you'll sing it along with us.
one, two. There we go. Good morning. Man, that was great, wasn't it? So, yeah, I don't know. So, all right, come stand by me for a second. So, many of you may know this and some may not. 5 years ago this weekend, we launched the West Campus. And so it's an exciting weekend for me to think back on all that God has done. We've seen lives change. We've seen people come to Christ and walking in a relationship with Him. We've seen marriages restored since we've launched out here. We've seen people go on mission trips, and we've seen a lot of great things, haven't we? Yeah. And God has done a lot, and He grows us all in different ways. And Ari came to me and Pastor Tom a few months ago and let us know that God was growing her in a way that she maybe didn't expect, and asking her to take a step of faith. And sometimes when God asks us to take a step of faith, we know what He wants us to do, and it's much easier to do that. But sometimes God doesn't share with us exactly what that means. And so in Ari's case, she said to us, she said, God's asking me to take a step of faith, but He hasn't told me where I'm going or what I'm doing yet. And so we said, okay, what does that mean? She said, well, she said, I know that part of that step means that I need to step down from leading worship at the West Campus. And so, that's what we did. you know, we took a moment to try to gather ourselves after we heard that. And so she just said, you know, God's calling me into other areas. She's been going to school, going to finish college here in a week, right? And so she's going to have her college degree done, and that's been a journey in itself, and God has been growing her every step of the way. She came up through our youth group, youth band, and done so many different things for us, and we're so thankful. But one of the things, if you follow her on any of her social media, you know that her and her husband Will recently purchased a CrossFit gym, and so they're starting a business together, and a CrossFit gym is a great place to do ministry. Think about all the people coming in the doors each and every day. So we said, maybe that's part of the stepping out on faith. And so we're not really sure where Ari's going to land as far as what God has for her, but she has told us that she's going to be moving on, and so I needed to share that with you this morning with a heavy heart, but also a joyful and expectant heart to see what God is going to do in her life and in Will's life. And so they're going to be moving on to do that. And with that said, the 29th of this month is going to be her last Sunday leading on in the morning. And as some of our team asked this morning, will she come back and be a guest worship leader? She may do that from time to time. You know, people need vacations, need a break. So that's our hope, that she will continue to do that from time to time. But so the 29th is the last Sunday, but on the 22nd, 2 weeks from today, we'll take some time to properly say thank you to Ari, have a reception after the service briefly to just give you all a time to visit with her. You can do that today after service too, but a proper time to just say thank you to Ari for all that she's done for us here at the West Campus and on the main campus every Saturday night. And so we're looking forward to celebrating that with Ari in just 2 weeks, and Will as well. And some might be saying, well, who's going to lead next? And Lindsay Roop, who has filled in here on more than one occasion and is also a Morningside kind of homegrown. She's grown up here at Morningside, and she currently works for our academy, and she's agreed to take on our Saturday nights and our Sunday worship for us. And so, yeah, and so we're excited about that. Actually, you can wave. I wasn't even thinking. You can wave to everybody. Lindsay's sitting over here if you want to say hi to her after service too. So we're thankful that Lindsay is joining the team in that respect, and God is going to continue to do great things here. Frankly, 5 years in one place as it relates to ministry and statistics, 5 years is actually a long time. The statistic shows that worship leaders move to a different church every 2 to 3 years, actually. And so Ari hasn't just been with us. She's been with us out here for 5 years, but she's been in our worship ministry program for much longer than that. And so God has blessed us richly for allowing her to be with us for the amount of time He has. So take a moment today to say thank you to Ari. We'll do it properly here in a couple of weeks, but we wanted to give everybody time to digest that as well. So let's pray for Ari and Will right now. Lord, we love You and we thank You. for Ari, for Will, for all that they have contributed to this ministry here at Morningside, and their love and their hearts for you. God, I pray that you'll bless them in whatever the next endeavor is you have for them. We know CrossFit Gym is one of those things. God, starting a business is difficult. I pray that you'll go before them, that you'll order their steps, that you'll make their path straight, that you'll open the doors that need to be open and close the doors that need to be closed. God, I pray that as a church family, you'll help us to continue being that family for Ari and Will, to continue to pray for them as they take these steps of faith, not knowing exactly what tomorrow might hold, but knowing that you hold the future. And so we thank you that you hold the future, and we thank you that you're going to show them exactly what you want them to do, and that you're going to touch lives through whatever ministries you draw them into next. And we just thank you for these last 5 years out here at the West, and the way that she has just poured her joy and shared her joy from the stage with each and every person and made us all better for it. We thank you for that, Lord, and pray that you would bless both of them richly in the days to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you, Ari. Check out the screens. So this morning, you can take out your outline that says, we are the church. It says, we're better together, right? And so one of the things we're called to do as the church is to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And the good news brings people joy. And joy is what we're going to be talking about this morning for a couple minutes. Before we get into that, as you're taking out your outlines and getting your pens and all that stuff, just want to share with you that Christmas Eve services are going to be on the East Campus, the main campus over on Morningside Boulevard at 5 and 7 p.m. We're choosing to not do it here as well because we have a special guest, Adlin Cruz. Adlin Cruz is the pianist. Some of you have heard him before. He's an international recording artist. He is phenomenal. It's going to be a great night with the wise men and the manger scene and everything, candle lighting, traditional candle lighting. And so I will tell you that on the 22nd, we will also do a candle lighting out here at the end of the service. For those who are like, well, we want to do candle lighting at our own church out at the West, that's fine. We'll do that out here as well. It's a great time. There's no rules that say you can't do candle lighting more than one time at Christmas. And so we will do that as well out here. But 5 and 7 o'clock, we want to celebrate as a total church family on our main campus. And so I encourage you to make plans to be out there for that. It's going to be a great time together. So talking about God's gift of joy to you this Christmas. And so today we're going to take a look at what that means and how God wants to give you and I indescribable joy. 1 Thessalonians 5:16, a verse that you've probably read in its entirety more than once in your life, but the tag in that verse out of 1 Thessalonians 5 says, always be what? Joyful. Always be joyful. And we look at a verse like that, and if you've had a particularly rough week, to be honest, when you hear a verse like that, doesn't it kind of bug you? You know, the Bible says always be joyful, and you think, well, you don't know what I went through this week. You don't know what kind of circumstances I faced this week. You don't know the argument that I had at work this week. And we think it's hard to be joyful all the time. But that's what the scripture commands. And so we sing joy to the world at Christmas, right? And it's a song that we all know. They even sang it when they lit the Christmas tree at Rockefeller Center this week. I was shocked because they sang all the verses, joy to the world, the Lord has come. You know, I'm thinking, man, I can't believe it. But it's why do they sing that? Why do we sing joy to the world? Because joy is not just for a select group of people. Joy is not just for a select demographic. Joy is for everyone, everywhere. But is that really possible in the day and age we live in? Is it really possible to have true joy in this world? There are a couple things that keep us from feeling like that's a possibility. Things that you and I face on a daily basis. One of those things is the bad that shouldn't happen. The bad that we think shouldn't happen keeps us from experiencing the joy that God wants us to have. We all have to admit that a lot of the bad things that happen in life are because of our own stupidity or our own mistakes. But there are bad things that happen to us, and there are bad things that happen to other people in this world that just shouldn't happen. Not things that we brought onto ourselves. No one deserved it. They were innocent people, innocent bystanders. And because of that, we wonder, can joy really happen in this world? And alongside that, you put the second thing, not only the bad that shouldn't happen, but the good that doesn't happen. The good that doesn't happen. The good things that we want to happen in our lives. The dream that we've had that doesn't seem to be coming true. Or the heart that we hope to change in somebody else so that we could get along with them. Or so that that relationship would be reconciled. That never seems to really change. Or maybe it's the prayer that we've prayed over and over and over that just doesn't seem to get answered. Or at least it doesn't get answered in the way that we would really like it to be answered or expect it to be answered. And you look at these real life truths and that we have to face every day, and you realize that if joy is going to work, you can't wait for perfect circumstances. Because we don't live in a world of perfect circumstances, right? If joy is going to work, joy has to work in the imperfect, often ugly world that we live in. And that's what the message of Jesus Christ is all about at Christmas. God came to this often ugly and imperfect world in Jesus Christ, and he told us that joy, true joy, can happen even here in the midst of this mess. Even in your kind of world, he said, joy can happen. And so because of the kind of world we live in, you can choose to be a discouraged person because there's a lot to be discouraged about, right? Or you could choose to be an angry person because there's a lot to be angry about in this world. Or you could choose to be a cynical person because there's truthfully a lot to be cynical about. The message of Christmas is because Jesus came, you can also choose joy. You can also choose to be a joyful person because the truth is there's a lot to be joyful about. I was shocked. I preached this entire message last night on the main campus, and this person was waiting to see me after the service. And I'll admit, pastors sometimes have worldly thoughts. I'm thinking Big Ten championship football game at 8 o'clock, right? And this person is waiting to see me, and I'm just being honest this morning. And she proceeds to talk, and 45 minutes later, close to 9 o'clock, she finally says, I know you probably need to go, but just one more thing, right? And it just goes on and on. And what was interesting is I just talked about this message of Christmas and how we have the right to choose joy and how God gives us the choice. And everything that I heard was discouraged, angry, cynical, all the things that I had just listed in the message. And I tried to time and time again refocus that conversation and refocus towards joy, and it was just nearly impossible. And I thought, there are things that were mentioned that could have been taken as joy and joyful moments, but they were perceived in the other light. And so what I'm trying to help you understand is, you can hear a message, I can preach about joy until I'm blue in the face, but the truth is that ultimately, I can't choose it for you. You have to make the choice yourself. The message of Christmas is that because Jesus came, you get to choose whether or not you're going to be a joyful person. It's a new choice. It's a new day because of what Jesus Christ alone has done. You may have heard someone say before, well, you know, joy is a choice. It just doesn't happen in our lives. The question I've got is how? How do you choose it? I've talked a lot about it, but how do you choose it? It's obviously not an automatic thing, right? Because a lot of us have circumstances that it's kind of hard to have joy in those circumstances. So how do you choose it? And even those of you who have been Christians for quite some time, you know that it's a choice, but in the midst of those hard circumstances, sometimes it's not the easiest thing to do. It doesn't automatically happen. So how does it happen? How do you choose joy? Well, imagine a map for a minute. You go to the mall, and everybody goes to the mall this time of year, right? You go to the mall, and if you're looking for a specific store, you find the map that has the little red dot, and it says, you are here. So imagine a map in your mind, and it says, you are here, right here. And it says, joy, and joy is way over there, and there's an arrow that points at how to get over to joy, right? And maybe the you are here for you right now is your ordinary routine, or maybe it's your boring life, or maybe it's your painful, difficult life, or maybe it's the relationship mess that you're in, or the coworker issues that you're having, and the you are here is right here, and you're just hoping that someday you can get over there to joy. The question is, how do we get there? How does that happen in our lives? And what we have to do is we have to focus on what only God can do, only the joy that he can bring. And so this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at some guys in Scripture that show us how to get from here, the ordinary, the boring, the mundane, the complicated, the difficult, the stressful, all of that. How do we get from here over to there where joy is? And we're going to talk about the shepherds. They were in one place, and the angel said, the good news is going to be found over in another place. They were out in the fields in Bethlehem, right? You remember this story. And God brought them a message of great joy, what we're talking about this morning. And they made some choices, some simple, simple choices. The same kind of choices that you and I can make today that bring joy into their lives. So if you want to have joy, here's three choices that result in joy. Number one, choose to hear the good news. Choose to hear the good news. You ever been really down and you get that phone call and it's finally some good news and it just lifts you up and you get excited and all of a sudden you have a moment where your spirits are lifted? Listen, good news has the power to bring joy into our lives. It's the kind of thing that happened to these shepherds the first Christmas. Luke chapter 2 verse 10 says this, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid. Why did the angel have to say do not be afraid? How many times do you think the shepherds saw a huge host of angels show up in the clouds singing glory to God in the highest, right? Doesn't happen every night. So the angel shows up and says, don't be afraid. Why shouldn't they be afraid? Because I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Not some people, not just you guys, not just a certain demographic, not if your skin color is the right color. Good news of great joy for all people. Not just for the shepherds. Now you think, well, maybe I just showed up today and you think you just kind of showed up because that's what you do on Sunday. It's Christmas time and I have to go to church, right? But in the middle of all of that, in the middle of this life, God came this morning to say, I want to bring you some good news this morning. I want you to experience my joy. What's the good news? The good news is that Jesus came. Sounds simple, but that's the good news. It's the greatest news. Jesus came. He came to make a difference in our lives. The good news is the fact that Jesus Christ came to this earth to tell us that God himself, our creator, the author and finisher of our faith, he loves us. The good news is that God offers forgiveness for the wrongs that we've done. And he offers a new sense of direction when we feel like our life is out of control and we don't know which way to go next. The good news is that God cares for the struggles that you're going through right now. And he can also make a difference in the direction of your life. That's the good news that Jesus Christ came to bring. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 tells us how good this news really is. And it says, I am not ashamed of this good news about Christ. It is God's powerful method of bringing all who believe it to heaven. Now everyone is invited to come to God in this same way. I would circle that word, invited. Invited. The good news is that God has invited you to have a relationship with him. He's invited you to discover what that is like. That's what Christmas is all about a relationship with God, your creator. And the way that you respond is that you talk to him in prayer and you say, you know what, God? I want this good news to be a part of my life. That's what the good news is all about. Christmas means that God called you, and he didn't call you to give you bad news. One of the problems is that joy only seems to last, and some of you know this, joy only seems to last as long as the good news lasts, right? Have you seen that? Sometimes it only seems to last for a few minutes. So how do you find the kind of joy that's going to last for eternity? How do you find the kind of joy that's going to last you the rest of your life? How do you find the kind of joy that's going to last you through any circumstance, any trial, any disappointment that you go through? Well, maybe you look at your life and you say, well, my life's filled with problems. Is there any good news in that? There is. There actually is if you know him, if you know Jesus Christ. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 3. We just finished 15 weeks in the book of James, right? And James in the very first chapter, in the second and third verse says, dear brothers and sisters, whenever trouble comes your way, let it be an opportunity for what? For joy. For when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So I'm not joyful that I have troubles. Who would be, right? Who would be joyful for the troubles? But the joy is in the fact that God can work even through the struggles of life, as I put my faith in Him, as I put my trust in Him, God can work through those circumstances to help me grow, to help me change, to help me grow to be more like Him. That's the good news. Joy isn't perfect circumstances. Joy isn't having perfect circumstances. Otherwise, none of us would ever, ever, ever experience joy. Because how many in here have experienced perfect circumstances day in and day out every day of their life? Nobody. Joy is not smile and the world will smile with you. Joy is not, well, every cloud has a silver lining. Listen, some clouds are big, black, dark thunderclouds. And they're followed by other big, black, dark thunderclouds. Aren't you glad you came to church to be encouraged by this morning, right? But that's the truth of life. So how do you find joy in that? That's a great question. Well, how do you find joy when things aren't going well? Joy isn't found in perfect circumstances. I don't know if there's a place on your outline to write this, but you might want to jot this down. Listen, joy is applying God's truth and God's power to our imperfect circumstances in this imperfect world. I'll say it again. Joy is applying God's truth, that's His word right here that you should be spending time in, that we should all be spending time in, right? Joy is applying God's truth and God's power to our imperfect circumstances in this imperfect world. You might say, well, Pastor Scott, that's easy for you to say, but I've lost everything. Is there any joy in that? I've lost everything that matters to me. Is there any joy in that? Well, there is if you know Him. Hebrews chapter 10 says, you even had joy when all that you owned was taken from you because you knew that you had something better and more lasting. The joy that God gives is the joy that no man, no woman, no politician can ever, ever take from you. Ever. And because of what God has done through Jesus Christ, because of the hope that He gives us for eternity, you can have nothing to look forward to in this earthly world and still look forward to joy. Because this world is not all that there is. God is building for each and every one of us an eternity of joy. And that this morning is good news. For some of you, it's the only good news that you can hang on to right now. But listen, it's enough. And it's enough even in the difficult times. The good news that God loves you, the good news that God wants to be a part of your life, the good news that God wants to forgive you for the things that you've done and give you an eternity with Him, that's good news. And when you listen to that good news, the truth is that whatever else is happening in life, the result is joy. And the shepherds teach us that. They also teach us a second thing about where joy comes from. And it starts when you listen. We said it starts when you listen to the good news, but it continues when you choose to do what God says. Joy continues when you choose to do what God says. These shepherds heard God tell them to go and find a baby, right? Wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And a manger is what? A feeding trough for cows. And so the shepherds went and they did. They found everything to be exactly as the angels had told them. And when they found the baby Jesus lying in the manger, what they found and what they experienced in that moment was joy. Luke chapter 2, verse 15 says, when the angel had left them and went into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. Why did they go? Why did they do that? Remember we said you have to make a choice to follow. You have to make a choice to do what God says. They went because they believed what God had said to them through the angels. And because they believed what God had said, they went to Bethlehem. They made the journey to Bethlehem. And they could have spent they could have spent the rest of their lives wondering what would have happened. They could have said, well, I don't know if it's really true. Do you think all that stuff we just saw is really true? Should we really go? Listen, if God sends angels that show up in the sky out in the middle of nowhere and says, go do this, I think I'm going to do it, right? But I know people that would say, nah, that's too good to be true. That wasn't really meant for me. And they just wouldn't go. Because they're just Debbie Downer, right? You know, and so they say, that's not for me. But the shepherds choose to go. They choose to go see what it's all about. And they could have stayed, and they could have sat on their hands and done nothing, and they could have always wondered, what would have happened if we had gone? What would have happened if that night we would have taken that step of faith and done what the angel said? But instead, they trusted, and they went and did what God said. Figuratively, listen, there are a lot of us that it's easy to get stuck out in the fields outside of Bethlehem. You hear God say to you, trust me with your life. Trust me with this decision. Trust me with these, with your relationship issues. But you just stay there, and you just kind of wonder, and you wonder, what would have happened if I'd have trusted God with this? Or what would have happened if I'd have done what God told me over here? And maybe this happened years ago for you, but listen, I'm here to tell you this morning that it's not too late to trust him. It's not too late to go to Jesus Christ and to find hope in him. It's not too late. You don't have to wonder any longer. Today may be your day to trust him for the first time. Maybe your day to ask him to help you with that decision, or to help you in those difficult circumstances, or to help you with your relationships. You don't have to wonder anymore. And joy happens when in our lives we decide to do what God says to do instead of what we think we should do. Psalm 19 verse 8 says, "The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are clear, giving insight to life." In other words, God's commandments bring joy into our lives. And some of us think, well, that's a little odd. You know, we think, if I mention the Ten Commandments, the first thing you think of isn't necessarily joy, right? When I mention the Ten Commandments, you maybe think, you know, restricted, lots of rules, maybe good for living, but we kind of think they're hard to live by or they're difficult. And the first thing we think of is definitely not joy. But God gave us these commandments, these directions to give us joy. Why do we as parents give our children rules to follow in our home? Not because we want to be killjoys and be the worst parents in the world, but because we know what will protect them, we know what will help them, we know what will help them grow, we know what will bring joy into their lives and happiness in their lives. So we give our kids structure, we give our kids rules. The Ten Commandments were given by God, our Creator, for the same reason. Not to be restrictive, not to make us miserable, but to bring us joy. Because God says, I know how you should be living your life. It's a matter of not whether or not you want to follow this plan. And when you do what God says, when you follow and you take action on his commands and you do what he says, the end result, the truth that you find is joy. Joy is not the circumstances always working out in your favor. Joy is not the circumstances always working out the way that you see them working out or the way that you want them to work out. Listen, joy is following God in spite of your circumstances. Joy is following God in spite of your circumstances. The Bible tells us in Psalm 97, verse 11, light shines on the godly and joy on those who do right. When you do what God says, it brings joy into your life. A different kind of joy than you've ever experienced before. One of the things that God tells us to do is he tells us to ask. At Christmas, when we're asking everybody for things and we're trying to find out what everybody else wants, right? And we're trying to figure out what we're going to ask for Christmas, God tells us, he tells each and every one of us to ask. And he tells us when we ask, it brings us joy. John 16, verse 24, until now, he says, you've not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. I would circle that word, ask. It's a great reminder. What are you asking God for this Christmas? We ask a lot of other people for a lot of material things, but what are you asking God for this Christmas? Some of you think, well, I don't know if I can ask this of him. I don't know if I should ask him for this particular request. Well, listen, he'll tell you if it's a wrong request. He'll let you know if you're asking for the wrong thing or with the wrong motives. More than likely, if it's something that's on your heart, as a loving father, he wants to give it to you. He wants to make that happen for you. I found that joy doesn't come necessarily when I ask, but it comes when I receive. Joy comes when the prayer gets answered. When you pray a prayer that you've been praying and you've been asking God, the real joy comes when you see that prayer being answered and you see that God is working in your life. So one of the things that you need to do when you ask is remember what you asked for. Have you ever given people a Christmas list and they buy you something and you open it up and you look at it kind of cross-eyed and they're like, well, you wanted that, right? And you're looking at it like, why would I ever want this? And then they pull out the list and they say, no, you wrote it right here. That's what you wanted. And then you try to put on that fake smile and say, oh, yeah, that's right. I totally forgot. I so wanted this present, right? We have a tendency to forget sometimes the things that we've asked for. And so what I would encourage you to do this Christmas, the things that you're asking God for, write them down. Make a list. And then when he answers, or if he even gives a partial answer and he starts to show you the answer, write down what the answer is next to what you asked. Write down the date that he started the answer, or write down the date that he gave you the answer that you were looking for, or the direction that you were looking for. Why should you do that? Because that'll bring you joy. Because you'll see that the God who created you, the God that loves you, the God that has a perfect plan and purpose for your life is answering you and still does miracles today, still answers prayers today. He's not a God for 2,000 years ago. He's a God for 2019 for each and every one of you here today. And that will bring you joy in your heart. Now, he might not answer exactly the way you want him to answer. More than likely, a lot of times, he answers in greater ways than we could have ever expected. That's why, because that's what God is like. So when you ask and you receive, it brings you joy. Joy comes when you hear the good news. Joy comes when you do what God says. Then there's a third thing the shepherds remind us of. Joy comes when you choose to tell someone else. The shepherds show us that joy comes when you choose to tell someone else. When you choose to share the good news with somebody else. A principle of joy is this. Joy cannot be bottled. Joy cannot be bottled. If you try to put a cap on joy and hold on to it, it sours every time. Joy has to be shared. Joy should be contagious. It should be something that we share every day with everybody that we come into contact with. Much better than sharing our head colds and things like that, right? These shepherds immediately shared the good news about what God was doing. Look at Luke chapter 2, verse 17. When they'd seen him, who'd they see? Baby Jesus, right? When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. In other words, they went out through the entire town, and they immediately told anybody that they came into contact with, tell someone else. It's what you and I need to do. Psalm 107, verse 22, with joy they should tell what he has done. With joy, you and I should tell what God has done in our lives. Tell someone in your family. Tell someone at work. Tell someone at school. Joy happens when you tell someone else the good news. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. There's almost an indescribable burst of joy that happens when you share with somebody else good news about what God has done in your life. It's a multiplying kind of joy. And there's a multiplying kind of power of telling the good news. Luke chapter 15 tells us why there's such a burst of joy. It says, I tell you, there is more joy in heaven over one sinner who changes his heart and life than over 99 good people who don't need to change. So when you tell somebody the good news, and when they accept that good news, the Bible says that not only do the people on earth rejoice, but the people, all of the angels in heaven are rejoicing with you. They're rejoicing about that change of life too. The joy of telling others the good news is the joy of telling someone that everything can change for the better. Not every circumstance, not every trouble, not every problem, right? Because some of the troubles and the problems that we have, we created, and God says there's a price to pay for the choices that we make. But everything about who you are and your purpose in life and your direction in life can change when you come into contact with the good news and the one the good news is about, Jesus Christ. It changes everything, and you can be forgiven, and you can have a fresh start in life, and you can have new strength for the struggle that you're going through and a new hope for your future for the first time in maybe a long time. That's what joy is all about. Joy is a choice. And some of you, you're going through difficult days. You're going through struggles. Yet your lives are filled with joy. And you've chosen to have joy even in the difficult circumstances. In spite of the circumstances, you're listening to the good news and you're doing what God says and you're telling other people. Some of you are telling people in hospitals as you walk in each and every week for your chemo treatments for cancer. And you're witnessing to nurses and doctors and everybody else. And you've chosen to set your heart on the kind of joy that only God can bring in our lives in the midst of those circumstances. That's where joy comes from. You choose to hear something, you choose to do something, you choose to say something. You hear the good news, you do what God says, you tell other people. Christmas is a time that most of us enjoy, right? Statistics say that 75% of us say it's the favorite time of the year for us. Yet it's just a season. So how do we have joy not just at Christmas time, but the joy that lasts for more than a few weeks, a joy that lasts year-round? A joy that lasts in every season of life. Well, Philippians chapter 4, and we'll be done, says this. Be full of joy in the Lord always. I will say it again, be full of joy. Or other versions say, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. I would circle the word in the Lord, that phrase in the Lord. Why would you circle in the Lord? That's where your joy comes from. Not your circumstances, not how much money's in your bank account, not where you're going to travel this Christmas. Joy is found in the Lord. Not based on your circumstances, it's based on Christ. It's in the Lord that we can find a joy that will last us for an eternity. And He's already called you. He's connected with you, and that's what Christmas is saying. He wants to have a relationship with you. And now it's our turn to respond. Some of you already have. But some of you, for the first time today, maybe need to respond to that and say to Him, you know what? Jesus, I do need to trust you. I realize it's not about religion. I realize it's about a relationship with you. That's what Christianity is. It's a relationship with our Creator, a God who loves us, a God who loved us enough to send His Son to this earth to die on the cross. He lived a perfect life, died on the cross, defeated sin and death so that we could have everlasting life with Him. That's where true joy is found. So maybe you've been thinking about this for a long time, but it's hitting you for the first time today. You know what? I'm going through some difficult times. It's hard to have joy at Christmas. And I need God's good news of great joy in my life. Listen, God's gift to you this Christmas is a gift of good news. He wants to have a relationship with you. And you start just by talking to Him in prayer, by trusting Him, by telling Him. And I want to take that opportunity right now. So if you would, bow your heads with me as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning. This Christmas is your Christmas to say to Jesus Christ, Jesus, I want you to be a part of my life. I want to accept your gift of joy. I want to accept your gift of strength. I want to accept your gift of power and forgiveness in my life. So if you're here today and you know you need to do that for the very first time, I just want to pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you, but just put your hand up so I can pray for you this morning. You say, I know I need to trust Jesus this morning with my life. I've never taken that step. And this morning, yes, I see your hand in the back. Yes. Anyone else? Yes, I see your hand. Say something to Him in your heart right where you sit. It's not the words that are necessarily important. It's your heart. It's say something like this. Jesus Christ, I need you in my life. I believe that you came to this earth, lived a perfect life, died on the cross for my sins, and rose again on the third day so that I might be able to find true joy and life and eternity with you. Jesus, today I know and I admit that I can't save myself and that I'm a sinner. But Jesus, I know that you can save me. And so today I place my faith and my trust in you for the very first time. Jesus, I thank you for the good news that you brought to this earth for me. Thank you for saving me. Help me to grow as I walk with you. In Jesus' name. And Lord, for those who are here this morning who are already Christians, trusted you with their life, they've accepted the good news, but you know, sometimes even things go bad in the Christian life, and we know that it's not a perfect life, but we know that when we walk with you, you make our path straight. But sometimes we lose focus of that, Lord, and so this morning, for each and every person here, I pray that you'll help us to remember this week, next week, in the coming year, I pray that you'll help us to remember to not just hear what you have to say, but to do what you say, because that brings joy to our lives. Lord, I pray that you would help us to also tell someone else. You commanded us to go into all the world sharing the good news. Lord, some of us have a hard time doing that at all. I pray that you'll just give us the strength and the courage to just start at home, right where we're at, with family or friends or neighbors, and share with even just one person this week the good news that you came at Christmas for each and every person, that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And we thank you for that this morning. Help us to hear. Help us to do what you say. Help us to share the good news with someone else this week, Lord. We love you and we thank you for the privilege that it is to serve you, to be called children of God. And I pray that you would bless each person here richly as they strive to serve you better this week. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Stand up. Give somebody a hug. Have a great week. We love you. Yeah.